Dr. McDonald has devoted several years of near full-time study to the subject. He has interviewed or conferred with all major participants who either officially or independently investigated certain aspects of the UFO problem. He is one of the most sought-after speakers. I found that out in trying to line him up for here, and he traveled extensively in the pursuit of his studies and investigating and lecturing on the subject. His present position is that of senior physicist, Institute of Atmospheric Physics, and professor, Department of Meteorology, University of Arizona in Tucson. The area of his principal research interest is atmospheric physics. His educational background includes a Bachelor of Arts degree in Chemistry, University of Omaha, 1942, Master of Science degree in Meteorology, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, 1945, and a Doctor of Philosophy degree, Physics, Iowa State University, 1951. He joined the University of Arizona staff in 1954, coming to the university from the University of Chicago, where he was on cloud physics project there as a research physicist. Prior to that, he was assistant professor of physics, Iowa State University, and during the World War II, he was a member of Naval Intelligence. His professional affiliations include American Meteorological Society, American Geophysical Union, the Royal Meteorological Society, American Association for the Advancement of Science, and Sigma Chi. Current professional activities of the doctors include is a member of the National Science Foundation Advisory Panel for Atmospheric Sciences, a member of the Advisory Panel for the U.S. Navy ESA project called Storm Fury. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences Panel on Weather and Climate Modification, and a member of the American Meteorological Society Publication Commission. Dr. McDonald will speak to us for about 45 minutes and then has consented to answer any questions that you might have on your mind. I'd like to mention also that an abstract of his paper will be mailed to me and mailed to each of you that are interested if you will contact me. With that, it is a pleasure to introduce our distinguished lecturer, Dr. McDonald.
Well, Gene, I'm very, very pleased to be here to talk to this AIAA section. I'm getting around to a lot of your fellow members this year, and I regard you as a professional audience as, in many ways, one of the most appropriate professional societies to before whom one might discuss this UFO problem for reasons that will become clearer a little bit later. I, as Gene pointed out, have been pursuing this problem fairly intensively for somewhat more than a couple of years. My impression is 180 degrees opposite to Dr. Condon's. Instead of agreeing with him in his recently released report, which is published, by the way, in a paperback version, if you haven't seen it, matter of books, he recommends that the matter should be dropped, that Project Blue Book should perhaps cease, and there's nothing of scientific significance. He even urges that school teachers should discourage students from reading books on UFOs. I say, conversely, that after interviewing about 500 witnesses here and in some foreign areas, talking to all of the Air Force people who have anything to do with the problem, checking many cases, that I think it may be one of the most important scientific problems before us, and that's a slight disagreement, as you can see. So we have something to keep the pot boiling. Let me quickly summarize some of the main points of my position so you see where I stand Then let me turn to the Condon Report. Initially, the title that I suggested for my talk was The Impact of the UFO Problem on the National Space Program, and I believe it will have such an impact. And I changed that title to Dissenting View of the Condon Report shortly after I saw the Condon Report, whose weakness and whose low scientific caliber is, in my opinion, sort of a scientific scandal. The total number of reports of observations by credible witnesses, reliable persons, of structured objects, craft-like or machine-like, objects that appear to be fabricated, not fuzzy blobs of light, the total number of reliable reports of structured objects that are now on record from all parts of the world are orders of magnitude too numerous to casually ignore the UFO problem any longer. The second main point I'd make is that global point that I inserted a moment ago. There is no evidence that this is, as one Englishman said, a California phenomenon. There is no reason to agree with the European skeptic Britisher who said it's America's answer to the Loch Ness Monster, because there are just as many sightings in England per square mile, and probably more. The largest wave of sightings that ever occurred, and I've talked to the Frenchman who investigated these, occurred in France in 1954. I have been in Australia, Tasmania, and New Zealand, have interviewed about 75 or 80 witnesses. There is no difference between what the Australians in the outback are seeing versus what Iowa farmers are seeing. It is a global problem. South America, Antarctic, Greenland Eskimos, South American Indians, French peasants, and so on. Third main point, that despite many efforts to explain it in conventional terms, to explain the puzzling cases, now there's a little bit of a semantic business here, but there are so many puzzling cases that have defied explanation for 20 years that, again, one can't put the problem aside. There are far, far more cases that have been explained, and there is no dispute at all between anyone who has ever studied the problem seriously that a majority of raw, quote, UFO reports, unquote, are misidentifications of lights in the sky, of Venus, fireballs above all, aircraft with strobe lights, and lots of other things. The bulk of reports are not significant. But one doesn't ignore a problem on the score that there's a lot of noise mixed in with the signal. You try to integrate to pick out the signal. The fourth point is that there has been no study in depth anywhere in the world of this problem, and that includes the 20 years of effort on the part of the United States Air Force, and I return to that point shortly. Fifth point, Congress, scientific community, editors and the like, have accepted, with few exceptions, the Air Force claims that Blue Book was pursuing the problem, finding nothing that defied scientific explanation. Sixth point is that although the Air Force has claimed that Blue Book, Project Blue Book undertaking, was of a scientific nature, and although they have frequently asserted in press releases from the Pentagon that the Air Force was using the best scientific talents available to it, I stand here able to defend hours on length, if you want to listen, the contention that that is utter eyewash. There has not been any application of the substantial scientific talent available to the United States Air Force, say Air Force Cambridge Research Labs and Air Weather Service and groups like that, on this problem. It's over-eager press people at SAFOI who are generating that kind of very unfortunately misleading information. If we had not all been told collectively that the Air Force was really digging into this and finding nothing, there would have been scientists long ago who would have closed with this problem, but everybody believed, as I did, that the Air Force must mean what it has said. But that is completely wrong. I could, as I say, talk for quite a long number of hours on specific in bits of evidence, cases, attesting to the superficial and incompetent manner in which the Air Force has handled its UFO investigations in the last 15 years. Now, one has to, I don't want to take a long time going into the history, but you have to separate very carefully the pre-1953 Air Force investigations from the post-1953, and the turning point was a CIA-convened panel, the Robertson panel. Don't get all excited about to dip into cloak and dagger stuff. I don't think the CIA cares at all about UFOs. Their concern at that time was real, primarily because of the many fast-track radar cases already on record by 1953. They convened this panel of quite eminent scientists who, after 3 or 4 days of looking at about 15 or 20 cases, decided there was nothing to it. And that was when the thing began really to go downhill, after having reached a high water mark in 52 with fairly serious investigations by a then rather active Blue Book group, headed particularly by Captain Ruppelt, whose book is one of the better sources of information on the whole problem. We have had scientific advice given to the Air Force. They have repeatedly gotten puzzled about their cases. They've gone to the scientific community and repeatedly, beginning with Irving Langmuir in 1948, who on what appears to be about a half a day investigation told the Air Force to forget it. Then the Rand Corporation, then one or two professors from MIT, then the Robertson panel of very good men. Luis Alvarez, the Nobelist last year, was one of the 5 members. Robertson was a relativist from Caltech. Berkner was a member of the panel, so on. Good men. Then came the Battelle Memorial Institute. You may think that the $500,000 spent recently with the Conan Committee is the first substantial outside expenditure. $400,000 was spent with the Battelle Memorial Institute, producing an almost useless document, Blue Book Report 14. Again, bad advice. Write down the history of the whole project through their consultantships, advisory panels, and so on. Again and again, you look back and you find the Air Force has been given what can only be described as snap judgments, not based on getting out and interviewing lots of witnesses, but just, oh, there's nothing to this. People see things. There are things in the atmosphere we don't know. That advice has continually turned the dial down on Air Force interest, and that is what I regard as the reason for failure of Air Force to respond to the many intra-Air Force cases, stunning cases on record in Project Blue Book files at Wright-Patterson. I've been up there 3 times. You can't imagine the intrinsic scientific interest in some of these cases, but they're all just explained away as probable birds, possible aircraft, maybe balloons and so on, and then a very small number that they finally concede are unidentified. Well, why hasn't the Air Force responded to that? Some people insist it's a CIA conspiracy at high levels. They know all about these. This hypothesis runs. And I'm not talking about nuts. I'm talking about serious investigators, particularly Major Keogh of NICAP, who's indeed a very serious investigator of this problem. But I believe he has failed. His background is not such that he could sense the impact of all that scientific advice, negative scientific advice, on the problem. And his contention that the CIA must know that these are extraterrestrial and is keeping this from the public by design, perhaps even keeping the Air Force somewhat in the dark, I reject that hypothesis, not casually, but after a great deal of thought. And I think it's all this bad scientific advice that has done it. And now comes the Condon Report as the largest single piece of bad scientific advice that I have yet had a chance to look at in this problem. And the mixture brought by the Condon Report is compounded by the strong endorsement given to it last month by the National Academy of Science. If you look at this month's Academy News Report, I just have a Xerox of it here, you will find a full statement of the Academy text of this endorsement, and they're really more negative than Condon himself, if anything. I say that is going to come home to roost on 2101 Constitution Avenue Northwest, and it'll be a check, and the Academy will have very great difficulty chasing off the Academy steps. That's a prediction which you can put me down for. The damage, I think, is greatly compounded by the strong Academy recommendation. Who did this? Who was it? Is it all 500 members of the Academy? Well, no. 11 Academy members, and this is a rare panel when you get all Academy, full Academy members on a panel. For instance, I'm on a National Academy panel, but I'm not a member of the Academy myself. But all of the members of this 11-man committee are full Academy members. And that sounds very prestigious. That has great carrying power with the editors. Read the New York Times. Read the Washington Star. The Star, for example, has some really charming editorials in the last month about it. We can sure forget all that nonsense. The Star said that now we won't hear any more about UFOs, except from those few borderline dinglings who will never shut up. Well, that's understandable. And the Academy comes down with all that approval. That's all you can expect. Well, I believe that with the Academy endorsement of the Conan Report and all of the editorial nodding of heads, that no progress will come now until adequate scientific rebuttal of the Conan Report is introduced into scientific channels. And that's where all of my effort is essentially going, and that's why I changed my topic to primary emphasis on the Conan Report. The AIAA, as some of you may know, has appointed a UFO subcommittee headed by Dr. Joke Kuettner at ESA, about 10 or 11 members, and in the December issue of your journal, they made their first brief report, and their recommendation, if you read it, is cautious and reserved, but again, 180 degrees away from the Condon recommendations. The Kuettner Committee points out it has not received adequate quantitative scientific attention, and it warrants more attention from AIAA, and they are giving it more attention. And I talked with the two of the members, including Kuettner, just last week in Washington, and they are preparing for AIAA journal preparation, a kind of a book review of this report, and I find they are not entirely in disagreement with me by any means. Well, now the Conan Report. Why is it that I have such strong, and I don't have to say again that those were strong objections that I put on record with you about this Conan Report. I don't think the kind of comments that I made are at all typical of one scientist describing another piece of scientific work, and by no means do I go around making statements like that on a casual basis. But I'm prepared to defend those strong words. First of all, there are only, in this report, there are only 90 cases discussed in anything like any detail at all. Now, that might seem to you like a lot of cases, but that's a drop in the bucket. Blue Book has 12,000 cases on file. I have checked several hundred on a shoestring basis. I did not have $500,000 to do it. But I've managed in about the same time that the Conan Committee was in existence to check several hundred cases. So there's one objection right off the bat, only 90 cases. Now the second, I'm going to just tick off these main points and then get down to some details. There are many weak or trivial cases of such irrelevance I would never have wasted any time on them. The hoax balloon cases or somebody seeing a meteor, one or two outright crackpot cases. And these dilute that sample of 90 in an undesirable way. Condon and group and his group should have looked only at the really puzzling cases, because that was their charge. Let's find adequate scientific explanations for the real puzzlers, the classic cases. And that leads me to my third main point. Some of the most puzzling classics of the UFO history are conspicuously absent from that sample of 90. In fact, there are so few there that you can tick these off on your hands and toes very, very quickly. Very few of the really famous classics. Furthermore, there are cases that they did investigate, which are not in there and should be. And I think I'll tell you about one of them, because it's not so far away from here, Redlands, California, February 4th of this last year, 1968. I'll return to that in a moment. The Colorado investigators were on the case. They gathered material. It is not there. I and others, three professors at the University of Redlands, regard that as quite a significant case. Let me come back to that a bit later. Other examples of missing cases. Third or fourth, there, and this is really the crux of the whole thing, there is a great deal of specious argumentation, weak, dubious argumentation To defend that, you definitely have to get down to cases, but I just pass over that as a major point, but let me come back to examples. First, there is a great deal of incomplete reporting of cases, cases about which I have a great deal of knowledge, where I have also investigated, in some cases, interviewed more witnesses than they have. The early Massachusetts case, a very interesting Air Force B-47 case that I'll tell you about. They by no means tell their reader all the relevant facts, and I don't know whether they just got tired or what is involved, but anyway, you do not get, by any means, the full flavor of many of those cases in there. Incomplete case reporting, in some cases, borders on misrepresentation of the facts. There's a great deal of irrelevant padding the page count indicates about a third of this deals with UFO cases, about two-thirds various kinds of sort of secondary. Some of it makes good reading, but a great deal of it is just like somebody writing a text on ufology or something, some kind of a book that might sell, and I guess it's selling. But that wasn't the problem. The problem was the close with these cases, to get right down to scientific details. There's no need for irrelevant discussion of all the nuts which exist, not just in California on this problem, but in many places. The next main point, and here is one that's a central point, and we don't have to argue at all about this. There are, in that mere sample of 90, if you look in the index under sightings, comma, unexplained, there are 27 listed there. There are five others that aren't even listed in the index that are conceded to be unexplained. That's a third of a sample. And some of these cases knock your eye out. Lake in East England, the RAF case, and this Texas B-47 case. Among the unexplained cases are some really, really significant cases. Conrad apparently shrugs his shoulder and walks away. It's unbelievable. I mean, never have I seen a scientific report, the contents of which had so little match with the summary recommendations made by the investigator. Now, this is very interesting because there is no evidence that anybody on the project besides Condon saw the summary recommendations. Apparently it's signed by Condon, and there's no indication yet that anybody else saw that. I can't turn that problem around and say that nobody did, but so far it appears to be just Condon. Yet he uses the first person plural. It says we, but it sounds like everybody, and it is, I'm afraid, Condon. Now, that could easily lead us off into a very pertinent part of the total problem. How could this happen? What is the history of this unusual project? If you want to get some insights into that, I reiterate the recommendation of Dr. J.A. Hynek, who has for 19 years been the Air Force scientific consultant on UFOs, and only in the last two of those switched his position from rather casual playing down of the problem to very real concern. He's not as far out on this problem as I am, but definitely urging greatly increased study. Hynek's comment was, when people ask him about reading the Condon report, he is going to say, and I quote him, to understand the Condon report, you have to read two books. So the Condon report and a book by Harkins, by Saunders and Harkins, UFOs, yes, another paperback. I didn't bring my copy along. But it's the inside story of what went on in that unbelievable project, and I commend to you the purchase of Saunders Harkins' book, and it'll answer some of the questions that are raised by this peculiar mismatch between Condon's recommendations and the contents. 15 or 20 really good unexplained, and a total of about 32 conceivably unexplained in a sample of 90. And Condon says, nothing here of further interest. No scientific problem. Blue book can be dropped, and school children shouldn't be allowed to read the books. Just very strange. The report does, to make a final comment, does have a few bright spots. There is some good work in it, particularly the photographic analysis by Hartman, and Ayer's section on possible instrumentation design for extended studies is quite businesslike and well done, and one or two other sections that are secondary to the main problem are reasonably done, and some of the case investigations merit applause, but relatively few. Okay, that's a quick rundown. I've now told you where I stand with respect to the problem. You've gotten, I hope, the impression that I take the problem very seriously, and I have given you summary comments, at least so far, about the kind of objections I hold with respect to the Conning report. Now let's get to some cases. Let me just to bring one close to home. Let's look at that Redlands case. There's so much to be said here, so much more than you can cover in 45 minutes. So much need to take case after case, discuss the credentials of the witnesses, discuss the all possible explanations. That takes time. If the case is even worth talking about, it ought not be possible to review it in 20 minutes, but one doesn't have this kind of time, so I compress and eliminate some points here and there. But in February 4th of 68, in Redlands, 7:15 in the evening, last year, what, 10 days or so ago, persons in a residential area up in the northwest side of Redland heard a noise and a lot of barking of dogs up and down the street, and out they went, and pretty soon the streets, several different streets, were full of people who were looking at an object overhead. The estimates given by many of them centered around a few hundred feet altitude for the object, and this later checked by crude triangulation. Some of the witnesses, about 30 witnesses, were interviewed by three professors at the University of Redlands. Dr. Philip Seth was the leader of the group. They got tired after interviewing that many and didn't pursue them further. I've interviewed about six or seven personally myself. These persons saw a disc, by the blackboard had sketched it, but just a disc-like object with something resembling ports or windows or luminous panels or something around the top, and some things that were described, perhaps loosely, perhaps erroneously, as light jets around the bottom of the object, and it was hovering by the time they got outside, no appreciable noise, and definitely not a helicopter, according to many of the observers. One of the witnesses was a police officer, and one of the persons a former Navy aviation personnel, and a lot of the people saw this thing, and from various directions, and it did indeed triangulate it about 300 feet up. Some people lined it up with a telephone pole, that sort of thing, knew which corner of the house they were by, and so on. It hovered for a minute or two motionless, then went straight up to about double its height. No emission of flames or sound, just went straight up to an estimated double height, still over this residential area, hovered again, and then went northeastward, and all witnesses agreed that it moved in a kind of a jerky fashion to what was estimated about six blocks northeast, hovered again, and then set off very high speed out to the north over the general vicinity of Norton Air Force Base. Checks with radar, nobody saw it on radar. Unfortunately, March is across the hills, and it was too low to be in the radar visible pattern from March, and reportedly no radar functioning at Norton that night. The 25 witnesses, urban area, close range sighting, machine-like, it's hard to use a word, machine-like, craft-like, those aren't very good words, but a structured object, that's the common denominator of this. The Air Force investigation was nil. The press interest was a one-inch story in the Redlands Facts. Here is a sighting in an American city, several dozen witnesses, and the local papers, and this problem has gone so far downhill that's when Redlands Facts had a one-inch story. Seth got interested in it, asked the paper to put a piece requesting further witnesses. It eventually got about 6 inches, over 6 column inches. Eventually was looked at by the Air Force. They claimed finally there was a light plane that was landing, and when the Redlands University professors checked, they found that the only planes that were landing at that time had landed by time was well pinned down for television programming reasons. A lot of people knew what program they were stepping out from when they saw this. And these planes had landed. They also came from the wrong side of town, yet that was the extent of the Air Force investigation. Colorado sent Fred Air out and did gather material on it, yet that case, investigated within the Conning Project, occurring within the active lifetime of the project, a significant case is not to be found in the Conning Report. Why not? Why should there be a report on a predictive landing of a balloon? This is a case in the Conning Report, case 43 or something. Somebody in California, I'm not trying to be funny about California, someone out here contacted Conning, said he was in telepathic communication with the spaceman, and a landing would be made on the 11 o'clock April 15th of 67, Bonneville slats, and I would have been in a hurry to hang the phone up, kind of set an investigator up there, and that's a case that's discussed in the report. Why are it Redlands? When you talk about nuts like that, where is he? Okay. Now, let's take another case that's not in there, a famous case, one of the classic cases, a significant case, scientifically very interesting, and representative of the whole class of UFO cases involving car stopping. This is Loveland, Texas, November 2nd of 57. Headline news when you occurred. For the 2 or 3 days half-life of journalistic interest, and the Air Force said it was ball lightning and wedding missions, and it was forgotten like the rest. Nine vehicles suffered engine failure and lights out. When they came near or were passed by, one or more, it's not clear whether this is all one thing going around or several, objects generally described as 100 to 200 feet long, glowing red or bluish-red, in this panhandle town of Texas, within about a 10-mile radius of the town, and within about an hour-and-a-half period near midnight, November 2nd and 3rd of 1957. Okay, there is one of the classic cases. I urged the Condon Report to check it. NICAP put it on its list when the Condon Report, the Condon Committee, asked for suggested cases. They had it on their list. I had it on mine. They, in fact, investigated. Norman Levine, one of the two men that Condon fired in that interesting blow-up, of which I'm very much in the middle, back in February of last year. For further details, see the Saunders Harkins book. Saunders is the other one who was fired, professor of psychology. Norman Levine, Dr. Levine, an electrical engineer, began to do, while he was still, before he was fired, was doing investigation on Loveland, got from Texas A&M all the radar film for that day, and confirmed with that radar film what I had already found by a separate meteorological analysis. There wasn't any sign of thunderstorm activity anywhere in that area. And I wish I, if I had slides, one of the slides I would have showed you was the same weather map that I showed General Cruikshank up at Wright-Patterson to get across to General Cruikshank, who's on top of Blue Book and here's the trouble, 40 other projects in the Foreign Technology Division. He's no longer there now, by the way. The interesting thing about this weather map, gentlemen, is that here is this famous case, which is explained as ball lightning from the severe thunderstorm activity and wet ignitions flooding out these nine cars, each of which had no trouble at all starting its wet ignition system right after the glowing object, the ball lightning, left. But you look at the weather map, a great big high pushed down over Texas. Not a ghost of a chance of any lightning activity. We need to look at this weather map to see it. When I looked at that, I was quite stunned. This was very early in the game when I was checking the case out in 1966, and I immediately went to the Texas weather data and our files at the Institute, and no rain anywhere near Loveland that night. No thunderstorm activity, big high, and yet the Air Force, the United States Air Force, said then and still is saying wet ignitions and ball lightning. Norm Levine, member of the project until Condon fired him, got A&M, Texas A&M radar full of, no radar echoes anywhere in the area. That case, significant, classic case, not in the Condon report. Why not?
Why spend 6 or 7 pages, as the report does, analyzing in detail a hoax balloon case April 1st, mind you, of 1967 in Boulder, when they don't talk about Loveland? Very, very puzzling, I would say.
Well, I could discuss more of the trivial cases, but let's get on to some examples of weak argumentation. An interesting case there are some classic cases, some of the real puzzlers in there, in the section done by Gordon Thayer, but that's where the bulk of the bad argumentation lies, in Thayer's section 3, chapter 5. Just one piece of tendentious argumentation after another. The number of probabilities, apparents, appears to be, seems to be, that you find in that section ought to be all flung tail to tail and flown on a kite over Boulder or something like that. The BOAC strata cruiser case of June 29, 1954, classic case. It occurred near Seven Islands in St. Lawrence. BBC did a documentary on UFOs some months ago, and I just 3 days ago finally got the tape of the audio of that, And the one reason I wanted to get the audio was Philip Daly, the producer, located James Howard, Captain James Howard, the pilot of that strata cruiser, and interviewed him at length. So this was the next best thing to getting to London and interviewing him myself. I'm trying to get further information by mail from Captain Howard. Very interesting case. And I just mentioned that Captain Howard has by no means been sent to Siberia as a result of seeing the UFO. BBC people told me a year ago that when the Concorde is flown, you might put it, if the Concorde is flown, the pilot will be Captain James Howard. That speaks a little bit for the credentials this pilot has. James Howard and five of the cockpit crew saw the objects independently of the passengers. The stewardess finally was asked by the passengers to go ask the flight deck people about what it was, and when she came in the door, she found all the flight deck people with their noses glued to the window, looking at one large object and six objects that had, according to the description, been moving in and out of the tops of a deck of 30 cube below them. They were at 19,000 feet, going about 300 knots north eastbound to England from New York, 19,000 feet. They had seen these objects flitting in and out of the clouds, and they climbed up to their altitude, and then the small objects, which were dark and seemed to be sort of elongated, moved in back and forth and maintained odd formation, sometimes they were all ahead, sometimes above and below, of this big object, and the big object appeared to change shape during the 18 minutes, and hence 90 miles, that it paced the strata cruiser towards Goose Bay. I won't try to give you all the details. They called for a fighter, and the objects left just before the F-86 came in. BBC located the stewardess. I guess she has a lot of kids now. She's no longer stewardizing, but she was on the program, and I had the pleasure of hearing directly, that is, the direct interview just a couple of nights ago, and I'm now trying to get further information. How does Tom and his group explain this? Well, it's very interesting
find the passage here. I think I've got it copied out.
It's quite one thing or another, but in the midst of groping for the final answer, the analyst suggests, now mind you, this is a strata cruiser, 30 knots, and looking for some explanation of the optical anomalies that they think are involved, the analyst says that perhaps the shock wave created the optical effects. Well, the dispatches a paragraph on that, and then goes on to the optical effect. It's proposed that the mirage of the distant horizon. Well, that's subject to quantitative discussion, and I have just finished computing the dip angle for the horizon from from arbitrary heights to arbitrary real or cloud-produced horizons. It's very simple computation in physical optics. And the pilot emphasized that the object was first seen below and estimated a few miles away, though he was very tentative about that. Evidently, and this is why I'm writing to Howard, is what were those angles? Because that's what you need. If it was anything more than about half a degree below the horizon, in appearance, not a chance of refraction producing this, for quite definite optical reasons. Nevertheless, that's what the reader is apparently left with, and the closing sentence is just charming. This unusual sighting should therefore be assigned, I'm reading from the comment report, to the category of some almost certainly natural phenomenon, which is so rare that it apparently has never been reported before or since. Now, if you use argumentation like that, you can explain UFOs, and I know somebody who's been doing that for 20 years in the United States Air Force. That's no better than what we were getting out of Blue Book. If we can't get a scientific group that will improve on Project Blue Book, by the way, I didn't tell you, Project Blue Book has for many years consisted of a secretary, a sergeant, and one officer. Typically a major, sometimes he's a captain. The major recently made lieutenant colonel, just outrageous explanations coming out of Blue Book, and many of these in this report are really not very much better. Well, I could cite many more examples of weak argumentation. Odessa, Washington, December 10th of 1952.
This is a case that I was that I stressed in my testimony before the House Committee on Science and Astronautics in July. And by the way, if you haven't seen that the proceedings of that, you ought to get it. It involved an F-94 that, according to the Blue Book report, and I've seen the Blue Book report, was in the air about 15 minutes trying to close with this large whitish object with two red lights coming out of windows. This is the phraseology you find in the Blue Book report, windows in quotes, but some kind of opening. Went out through the F-94. They occasionally had to rack the F-94 up tight to avoid collision with it. It would course reversals are described in the report, and very erratic maneuvers, 15 minutes, and two bright red lights. Well, how do they explain this? Read the kind of report. I won't try to read you to the bottom, but it says, this is typical of the appearance of a pilot balloon, a weather balloon, when seen by inexperienced personnel. The pilot said bigger than any known aircraft. They spent 15 minutes in this F-94 trying to close with weather balloon? Two bright lights? That's an example. An Air Force radar station at Continental Divide, January 26th of 1953. Visual and radar sighting of an object that was around for quite a few minutes. The details of the sort of sketch it in the air with my finger. It was first seen as a light, and they checked radar, unknown, about 10 miles away. It went north. This is very significant, a very involved path, north about 10 miles. Then I think it was 18 miles west, then north for about 14 miles, and then down this way. It was visible 10 miles away, naked eye, and gave a good strong radar echo. Let's explain as a pilot balloon again. Now, the only thing that has any radar cross-section on a pilot balloon, it's one nighttime observation, is the... I did one with the weather bureau. I want to make a mention when I have to one in briefcase. This is it's all wrapped up. But you know what it is? Hanging on a string, and it's one candle power light, and it's got some metal, and it still has enough, 5 to 10 square centimeters of radar cross-section at the most. Not very much by radar standards. And this thing can be seen with the naked eye on the photometric calculation for about 10,000 feet, about 2 miles. And this funny path that I went through in the air, this is recounted in the Connor report. This is explained as the Winslow piebald, which to make the explanation go, they have to say it must have been 1 hour late, because it's an hour and a half after standard piebald time. They have to say that it developed late, because here it is down at estimated 2,000 feet above terrain, and they concede, and this is correct, I checked the firewall, that it went to 15,000 feet and then burst, but they said it didn't burst, it must have gotten a leak and came down. Then they said there was a mesoscale low. Meteorologists may know what I mean by that. I don't think the Conning report does. Mesoscale low. You look at the weather map, there are no indications of a mesoscale low. But anyway, what kind of a mesoscale low would make a pilot balloon that has developed a leak and is an hour and a half late go through this kind of a maneuver? What kind of a pilot ball has a light that can be seen 10 miles away and have radar cross-section to show up at some 20 miles? Just no go, gentlemen. I've got the piebald, and the piebald was not late. The piebald was released in Winslow on time, burst at 15,000 feet, and that explanation is just nutty. That's typical of the specious argumentation that abounds in the Conning report, and I would only be beginning, but let me continue with some other cases. I could cite incomplete case reporting. But you only have a notion of what's really involved in the case. And let me tie two things together by telling you a really interesting report. I'd never heard of it before. Well, I've heard of it, but I never saw the details of it before I got my copy of the Conning report. It illustrates incomplete case reporting, and it illustrates unexplained in the Conning report. That is, cases which are conceded to be unexplained, and which, nevertheless, Dr. Conning shrugs off, turns away, and says, let's forget about all this nonsense, and you school kids ought not get credit for reading about anything like this. This is a B-47 over the Louisiana-Texas area, September 19th of 1957. The Conning report interviewed three of the crew. I have interviewed all six of the crew. since getting the founding report. It takes a little digging to find some of these people. One of them was Lawfitt, one just got back from Vietnam, is up at Vandenberg. Two are out of service, one is retired and up in Spokane. I located all six. Six because it was an RB-47 with ECM gear aboard, and that figures largely in this instance, the ECM gear of RB-47. You get the impression from reading this as case five in the counting report. I think you might agree, first of all, that you get the impression it all occurred around Fort Worth, maybe. Let me interject a comment. For the 59 named cases, they don't give date, location, or names of witnesses. Very bothersome to check the scientific material where the principal report doesn't give you names, dates, or locations. Above all, if you're trying to check whether they are, how are you going to do it? Well, it happens that many of these cases I already knew about, but some I still haven't pinned down, and you would never know from this particular discussion what a real case this is, because it really began down near Gulfport, Mississippi, and it really ended up in Oklahoma. And the UFO was with this 47 for a distance of over 600 miles and over an hour. The general impression, although UFOs are flashes of light that the people see, negative after images or something like that, and you can't expect them to be sure. But this involves a lot of detail. The ECM operator on number two radar monitor, his name is Major McClure, who is now at Offutt, Air Force Base, going to service, was puzzled as they came off the Gulf, northbound over Gulfport, to get signals at 2,800 megacycles from an apparent source on the starboard tail of the thing, as if it were out over the Gulf, which wasn't quite obviously right, but anyway, you do get the noise signals of one sort or another. Appeared to be a valid radar signal coming in. It was pulsed. Claire, when I asked him, said yes. It had even a PRF that was like a ground radar, and it had like a sleep frequency to it. So it looked like a valid ground signal. But on his monitor, now, mind you, in this part of the report, I am not talking about an airborne radar set bouncing signals off an unknown. I'm talking about a passive receiver, CM gear, that is designed to listen to the enemy radar, get bearings on it, to prepare to jam. You get the picture. It's passive reception of a signal from some source that I'm going to be talking about through much of this account. Very, very puzzling, as you will sense. The thing that began to puzzle in the core of the picture was not that it was off the Gulf, but that the tip on the scope began to move up scope rather than down scope. Now, you have nothing but DF, nothing but direction on this particular thing. You don't know range, for the obvious reason, but it moved up as if there were a ground radar set moving faster than the B-47, which was at 35,000 doing six to about 550 knots, and this force seemed to be going up scope. You got me? Now, that could be a noise signal, but it went around, and it could be that it was really moving down scope, but he had 180-degree ambiguity, and it was painting 180 out. And things do happen, as you well know. Radar is fallible, just as the human eye is. It went across the bow of the 47, came down the other side, which immediately ruled out the 180-degree ambiguity. McClure said he was so puzzled by this that he thought it must be something in the set. They haven't worked in any of the stations yet, and he didn't say anything to the cockpit crew, just puzzled around. In fact, he didn't say anything to the other EWOs on either side of him, both of whom I've talked to, it probably would have never been mentioned, and he would have forgotten it, except they went to Jackson and headed west over Jackson. Still, this whole thing is at 35,000 to the very end. Shortly after heading west towards Fort Worth, this was a 47 out of Forbes, Air Force Base. They were going to Fort Worth and north to Forbes in Kansas. So the next thing really began to warm up when the pilot, Phil Chase, suddenly saw coming in on a near collision course, 11 o'clock due in, a bright light which looked to him, he said, momentarily, it looked to him like landing lights of a jet, and he got on the interphone and alerted everybody to be prepared for sudden maneuver because he thought he was going to have to take evasion. But before anything else could occur, this light, which is all the one here so far, coming dead in and getting larger, suddenly, and he said at angular velocity far beyond the capability of anything that he knows of, went from 11 o'clock to 2 o'clock, just shot across like that, and blinked out. and now it's non-luminous, and that part of the luminous come in, way, oh, 2 o'clock and out. Okay, Major McCoy, the co-pilot, began kind of joking about maybe they saw a flying saucer on the interphone, and McCoy, back on the number two monitor, had the wit to tune back to 2800 megacycles, having just been puzzled 10 minutes before over Mississippi, to see, sure enough, bright, strong, he said, signal from 2 o'clock position. Read the counter report. All of this, you aren't told the counter report that it began in Gulfport. No comment at all about that part. But now, some of this is now in the counter report, and if Conan has read the report, he must have seen this next part. So, they began to try one thing or another to get rid of this, to shake it. Speed variations and so on, stayed at 2 o'clock. They were by then getting into the GCI ground radar coverage of Fort Worth, Cardwell, and Chase radioed to see if they're painting an unknown, and they were. They said there's an unknown 10 miles on your 10 miles away at your 2 o'clock position. He was identifiable by IFF, and the other no IFF is skimping. Okay, now they're going to be a little worried. Here, the thing has been staying with them. Here in a 600 knot flight, and the apparent equivalent of a ground radar set has been flying with them for some tens of minutes and quite a few miles, and it's painting on radar. So, the question is what to do next, but it was settled by the UFO, you might say. The next thing that happened was McClure said it's beginning to move forward on my scope, and immediately DCI radar announced quite independently, because they were hearing McClure, said it's beginning to move forward. So non-visible, non-luminous at this point, moves forward to dead ahead. Those motions appeared on the number two monitor, ALA 6 I think it was, and GCI painting it. When it got dead ahead, orange with a bright red light, very bright red light, in the 12 o'clock position. The pilot decided to try to culver it and went to full allowable power, but it stayed at the distance that the ground radar was saying was of the order of 10 miles, and they couldn't close on it. All of a sudden it began to veer northwestward. Again, none of this you would get from the counter report. You have the impression that something had occurred over at Fort Worth, but it went up between Dallas and Fort Worth. Chase said he got clearance from the FAA to clear all traffic out of the area, and he stayed at full power trying to close with this thing. All of a sudden, he thought seemed to stop, closure rate, visible. The GCI radar said it stopped. Here's a stationary echo. Still getting ECM received signal, still glowing red, and he veered a little because he didn't know what its altitude was, and he passed almost over it, he said, and it blinked out. It blinked out visually, the ECM signal disappeared from McClure's monitor, and it disappeared on DCI Carswell, all simultaneously. They put the thing into a turn, now getting more than casually interested, and as Chase pointed out, took about 20 miles to get halfway through the turn at the speed, and looked back all the time, and halfway through the turn, now over Mineral Wells, Texas, roughly, all of a sudden, on seeing the red light, a signal appeared on the GCI scope, compatible with direction, and on the ECM, and the GCI radar said it's back on the scope, position matched. So he requested permission to dive on it, which I suppose if anybody knew about this case, or maybe he should get some kind of a medal, or maybe be court-martialed or something. He elected to dive in his B-47, and did, and got down to 20,000, and the DCI was telling him they were closing to 5 miles, and all of a sudden it blinked out, disappeared from DCI, ECM signal gone, simultaneously. He was getting low on gas, he used the momentum of the dive to pull back to 25, to head north. Barely got the thing north, and here again, you don't get this from the county report. They came out here north into the Oklahoma area, and appeared on GCI, and they got it, and they said it's on your tail, and simultaneously, McClure got ECM signal again. It was not visible because in the 47, you can't see very well if anything's below you, and the evidence is now. He estimated when he died that it was somewhere near 15,000 feet. Apparently, he never got RHI indications out of the ground group. And there's no evidence that the subsequent history of this case. It turns out that ABC interrogated them. There was no report on this in Blue Book. They found out about it directly from Colonel Chase himself. But it finally went off scope and disappeared when they were up approaching Oklahoma City. Well, that's an unexplained case in time. It's taken me 15 minutes to tell you that. That's a lot of time by our standards. But I hope you can sense that maybe you ought to have a look at this report, too. Maybe you want to read the Lake and Heath Indian case, which involves ground radar, ground visual, and airborne visual. And lasted for 5 or 6 hours, involved 4 unknowns. It's not explained in the Conning Report. Conning says school children shouldn't read about this. Read about the case in the Conning Report in Utica, New York, where 3 different air crews, Albany Control Tower and Boston Radar, all involved in the sighting of an object which was between, it was a Mohawk Airlines DC-3, this is May of 55, and the DC-3 crew saw the object between them and the overcast, which is about 4,000 feet, so there's an upper limit here of range of a few hundred feet. They estimated to be about 150 feet across, and ellipsoidal, no wings, no tails. Greenish lights of some sort, this is a daytime observation, greenish lights emanating and going past above them at very high speed. Moments later, 2 other crews, some day had seen it, Albany Control Tower saw it going by on Victor 5 heading east, and Boston Radar saw it come in and go out on Victor 5, pass off the sea. That's not explained in the U.S. in the Conning Report. Well, it would take me 30 minutes to give you a summary of the Beverly, Massachusetts case. I've interviewed 10 witnesses in this case. The interesting parts of that case are kind of shrugged off. They're admitted to be unexplained in the report. It involves close range sighting by 5 adults, 2 police officers. The Millersville, Georgia case is in there. It's unexplained. I talked to the chief of police of Millersville, Georgia, and Lieutenant Neville and others. I could tell to discuss these. But there are some very interesting unexplained, which are essentially ignored in the recommendations that the Academy has seconded. I don't think they read the report. I think it's one more of those cases that happens all too often, and I, being a member of one Academy panel, I'm not entirely talking through my hat on this one, is the way things can go. You might test the tedious panels would do a lot more homework than they sometimes do, but I'm afraid that the fact that not one of these 11 members of the panel had any previous contact with the UFO problem, and that they deliberated for what is at most about 4 weeks, and they only had 1 meeting together, or 2 meetings together, as nearly as I could tell. I'm afraid it's one of those things that happens every once in a while, where a panel thinks, well, there's nothing to this, and or the conclusion is self-evident, we'll put our stamp on it. Ed Conning certainly has done a good job on this one. There's a lot of pages here, and a lot of diagrams, and you could thumb through that, you don't read a case or 2, and you might think, well, let's sure forget about that one. I'm afraid, as I said, that there's a chicken that's going to be roosting in Washington when the story is cleared up on this one. Well, to wind up then, you've heard me say that I think it's $500,000 the worst advice the Air Force has gotten yet, and I begin to temper my previous criticisms of Air Force mishandling. I don't change them, but I temper them. I've begun to sense something very clear to me before. It took a long time to settle in my mind, but all this bad advice, and I'd reached this decision before we had the Conning Report, has undoubtedly played a major factor in making the Air Force gloss over some of these fascinating cases. There are not nearly as many Navy cases as Air Force cases, and I don't think the Navy, the number in the Navy is not in as much trouble. They're in a little bit of trouble on this. They don't know it either. The Air Force doesn't know it either. Neither. But not nearly the trouble the Air Force is in. This one is just kind of funny, and as Navy people, you can smile at this one anyhow. This has been known for a while. I didn't check it for a long time, but I was asked by Bob Lowe, the one who really ran the project up there, unfortunately, for a list of what I felt were Air Force obfuscation cases. That is, where in one way or another, withholding of information or confusing of information or something like that was involved in a seemingly interesting case. Conning's group had entree to check these. They could have gone anywhere. They had an opportunity that was unprecedented, and I was among those who wanted to see them check cases like that, or the Red Bluff case, or the Oxnard, I think, 57 case, and a dozen others that I sent them Vernon's and Keith and Edward that I'll be talking about tonight over there. But this one, I have something particular wrong. There was 2 or 3 months later, I finally checked with Bob, and Bob Lowe did the check. He said, well, no, he said, after all, Rhode Island is a long ways away. But my comment on that one is that it wasn't any farther away, the person wasn't any farther than my telephone, and I talked to the people involved in this. I managed to locate one of the enlisted men. There were 2 chiefs and an enlisted radar controller on duty. This is a nighttime radar case. It doesn't involve any visual, and it is not, in essence, a terribly serious. The radar visual case is a good one, but this is a moving trick. They had been working for aircraft, nothing wrong with the set before or after, landing both before and after. It was also checked by one of the technicians right away when this thing occurred. No reason to think there's anything wrong with the set. These were rather experienced men, 10 and 11 years experience with the chiefs and the enlisted man, Sutchka, had a couple of years. Chief Pinkerton was the one who saw it first. You can see when the first one came on the scope, he was flabbergasted. Came in at high speed out of the southeast. He made rough computations of a series of blips and figured out to be around 5,000 miles an hour. It came in the southeast to about 10 or 15 miles range and went back out on a slightly different azimuth. When the next thing came on at high speed, he yelled, and the other 2 men came over and looked over his shoulder. The next one came in from a different azimuth, which is significant, and it came in to a different distance and went back on a different azimuth. It was northeast. And then still a third fast track appeared on this same scope, coming across on a secant, not even approximately original. Well, that's a funny collection of noise in any event. This doesn't look like anything like smoking or interference or whatever. Not characteristic of electronic noise. The men all emphasized that this was a good strong echo, and they compared it to a multi-engine, mother engine, multi-propeller craft, which of course has good cross-section, big blips, very high speed, and that typical noise. Well, the commander, his name is Corcoran, who is now in Spain, made the mistake of releasing this to the newspapers. And it was a few inches in the Washington papers. Well, the mistake was that he was forgetting Air Force Regulation 200-2, which had been on the books for many years and requires that all services report any unidentified through Project Blue Book. And that's where they all get buried. And it's been the target of many critics who say that's part of a conspiracy. I don't think it's part of a conspiracy. It's just the Air Force's way of trying to handle this thing and avoiding more bother than they already had. There's one anymore. Nevertheless, so that's what's happened. He let it out and he shouldn't have left. Because Commander Corson, the operations officer, had released it and went through the PIO, Sutchka, who had some interest in the UFO problem, wrote a letter to NICAP, the group in Washington, independent group, and mailed this. It was in the mailbag would have gone out. But a colonel from the Pentagon got on the phone when he read this in the paper and started chewing out the commander for having violated 200-2 in releasing this information. The commander didn't care much for. Then somebody told him, well, gee, Sutchka has just written a letter to a UFO group about this, and he got Sutchka in and made him get out of the mailbag, and fortunately for the commander, or whatever you say, for Sutchka, it hadn't gone out. He retrieved his letter from the mailbag, tore it up. And that would have been the end of it. But the Pentagon Air Force desk made its own press release about 5 days later and said that no visit to production, no checking of the set, no investigation of the credentials of these the 2 chiefs and the enlisted man, said that inexperienced operators and a malfunctioning set had been responsible for this unidentified. Well, that made the commander mad. And he got Sutchka, got a hold of Sutchka and said, go ahead and write that letter. And that's how it got to NICAP. That's how I heard about it. That's how I located Sutchka in Albuquerque. He was on his way to Vietnam. That's how I got some of the inside story. Well, now, that is the case. I wanted the Colorado group to check, but Bob Lowe said Rhode Island's too far away. You have my sentiments on this report. I believe the UFO problem is a problem of high order scientific importance. After 2 years and 500 witnesses, I cannot ignore the extraterrestrial hypothesis, which seems so nutty, which seems so absurd for reasons that we could now take an hour to discuss. All the reasons it can't be, you know them as well as I do. But, we're dealing here with such a large volume of evidence from frequently extremely credible witnesses of things that are way beyond the state of the art. Performance characteristics that are like, we're already in 1947, so far beyond the present state of the art, in 1947 things, that it's not terrestrial technology that we're dealing with here. It's not some Russian test vehicle. Russians wouldn't be testing a red-hot device in Melbourne, Australia, or Paris, or take the Hollywood case where people were bumper-to-bumper looking at the thing over La Brea and Sunset, I think it was, on February 5th of 1960. No American test pilot is going to be following Don Anderson's gas truck for 5 miles near Temple, Oklahoma, at bumper height, not knowing whether that thing is full of gas or not. No red-hot test pilot is going to be hovering over 3 women in Beverly, Massachusetts, and so on. You can say that for all of them. This is not advanced technology at all, not ours. It's not hallucination when you talk to credible witnesses, and I emphasize, I haven't begun to tell you about the interesting cases here. It's just unbelievable that this problem has stayed underground for 20 years. Absolutely unbelievable to me when you look at the evidence, the quality of the evidence. But then you look at what the Carter Report has done. It just tapped 20 years of bad sounding advice, and then it becomes understandable again why the generals didn't react. So I say we've got a problem here which AIAA should be looking at, and are, I'm glad to say. And I am pleased to report, sort of off the record, that Yoke Kutner and his people are not throwing in the towel just because Condon Committee has spoken, and I urge you to buy that Condon Report and read it for yourself and find out for yourselves the low scientific level of argumentation that backs up the negative parts, and to look for yourself at the also present strong material that's in that report that is ignored. And then perhaps you'll agree that it would be very desirable if some new effort were launched in Washington to get some really independent approach. And I could tell you all the negative success I've had in trying to do that. Everybody thinks it's a bunch of nonsense, just a bunch of borderline ding-a-lings. And I guess my closing comment should be ding-a-ling or something.
Dr. McDonald has time for some questions, if you like.
Dr., since we have done so much work in this country on this, there must be the same interest generated in England and France where there have been multiple sites. Has there been any technical written approach to collation and synthesizing what they've seen in these other countries?
Are there any foreign investigations comparable to the Air Force? Two comments. I wouldn't say that ours is at all. The implication that we have investigated the thing thoroughly, I differ with, but perhaps you don't want to start an argument.
A level of interest.
Comparable, right. Okay. Excuse me. The answer is no. There's no evidence of any comparable official investigation anywhere in the world. And as I was telling Gene this morning, Jacques Vallée, who's written two fairly good books on the UFO problem, a Frenchman who was in this country for a few years, and who is associated with many of the persons in France who have investigated, such as Aimé Michel, with whom I've also had exchanges, told me when I asked him, why didn't you fellows, after the big wave of 1954, do you know about that wave? That's really fascinating. Why didn't you go to the French Air Force and demand a French investigation? Well, we did, but they said, well, the American Air Force and all its money is spending 10 or 15 years in this. Why should we spend French money on it? And I really believe that the Russians probably, there are Russian sightings on record, and I think probably the United States Air Force has succeeded, not intentionally, as nearly as I can tell, in feeling the, sort of, bonus side effect was fooling everybody. You look, for example, at the Australian sightings, for which I have a fair amount of knowledge. The similarity between the RAF explanations, RAAF explanations in Australia, and Blue Book explanations is it's just unbelievable. The same silly explanations and the same failure to close with the problem. One man who has other intelligence duties does this. In the Air Ministry in England, persons whom I know have found, again, it's a couple of people who occasionally look into these things and are quite sure. Interesting case where the Air Ministry explained a sighting by a bunch of Coast Guardsmen, daytime sighting on objects hovering above Brixton, as probable reflections of headlights off a cloud, and that got the British Coast Guard up on their heels. Well, I don't think there's any investigation anywhere, unless it's very clandestine. A colleague of mine in one of the West Coast aerospace firms tells me that Argentina Air Force, does have some competent people checking the many Argentine cases, but I can't speak for first hand on that. I think the Air Force has misled a lot of people.
One more. Have you been committed any classified information on this?
I have no knowledge of any classified information, and obviously, I've done everything I could to find out if it existed. But I want to touch it. You understand my point. But I see no evidence. For instance, you go to Wright-Patterson, and to be sure, Project Mugu, which is a room about the whole Air Force headquarters thing, three people, is about as big as this, and the one wall is a great big dive-old file, and years of fascinating files over there. It's in a classified building. You've got to get clearance to get an FTD because it deals with some hot stuff. But a reporter can go in there without much trouble. You can see any of the cases. There are some cases where classified equipment, radar, requires that it be in another drawer, and the Colorado people tried to get close to that. But without going into a long harangue, I could discuss a lot of specific points that to me are strong indications we're not dealing with classified. Yeah, I've been in naval intelligence and have handled top secret material and have talked to plenty of people who are handling top secret material both before and after my duty in the Navy. And when you're touching on a sensitive subject, people don't keep that from you. They begin to react in a different way. It's clear you're talking about a classified subject. I've never run into that anywhere, civilian or military, Navy or Air Force. No indication. Not at all.
Yes, what about sightings?
Yes, so many points to take up. In the Conan report, the question is astronauts. In the Conan report, three of the unidentifieds conceded by the Conan committee are McDivitt's Gemini 4 visual and photographic observation of an unknown, Borman's Gemini 7, and Conrad's Gemini 11. I have talked to NASA personnel about this. NASA concedes they have no explanation for these three sightings. Those are conceded unknowns in the Conan report. Again, yet nothing of scientific significance in all this. There have been. That's an old one. That is trotted out by the skeptics. I spoke to a group of astronomers. I won't be very specific about this. The director of the lab, you begin to figure out where he was, but made that very same point in rebuttal to my briefing on the problem. And I knew three members of this man's staff, two of whom were in the room as he said this, who had, as amateur astronomers, seen ultraviolet objects that went past, but said, don't tell anybody about this, you know. And they were in the room, and Dr. K was asking me this question. Well, the answer is Clyde Tombaugh, discoverer of Pluto, saw an unknown over Las Cruces on August 19th to 49. Don't get me started, because I will read you off a long list of amateur astronomers who have seen these. They're like a lot of pilots. They don't tell about it very much, but they've seen them. Indeed.